Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today for our final summer series event, Fireside Chat with WarnerMedia's Christy Haubegger. And today's actually a special day. Today is Women's Equality Day, and it's a day that we celebrate the achievements of women's rights activists, but we also acknowledge that we still have miles to go in achieving true equality, especially for women of color. So today we're excited to hear from two amazing speakers who continue to stand up for diverse representation of women, especially in the entertainment industry. Before we kick off this conversation, I'd like to share a few event reminders. So all participants' mics will be on mute for the duration of the discussion. So we invite you to post in the chat your positive comments and reactions at the bottom of your screen. And if you need anything during the event, please reach out to Morgan, our staff member. Say hi to her in the chat. And you can also send her questions privately to if you have any questions for our speakers today. So please send those her way so that we can share at the end during our Q&A. So now I'm very excited to introduce one of our amazing Step Up alums, who participated in our mentorship programs during her high school years in Los Angeles. And she's actually going to tell you her own personal journey and passion for entertainment. And so she currently works as a partner manager at Collab Inc. She assembled a collection of top tier content creators, including Adam Ray Okay, Drea Knows Best, and Jaden Bartels across multiple platforms, including TikTok, Instagram, and YouTube. She saw an opportunity to support multicultural creators who do different types of content like fashion, beauty, and comedy. Her skills have helped raise the company's diverse profile and has been a great benefit to Collab's creators as they build their own personal brands. So please help me welcome Rocio Ramirez. Take it away, Rocio.
Thank you so much, Amanda, for the introduction. And thank you all, the Step Up community, for being here today and allowing me to share a little bit about my personal story and be part of this amazing lineup of women that I respect and admire. So thank you for that. But yes, as Amanda mentioned, I'm a Step Up alum. I graduated from high school in 2011, and then I went to study at Mount Holyoke College in Massachusetts and graduated from there in 2015. And honestly, I have to say that my transition from high school to college wouldn't have been as smooth as it was without the mentor support that I had through the Step Up programs, as well as certain experiences like the Bay Area College Tour that I took part of while I was in college. And for those who don't know what the Bay Area College Tour is, it's basically kind of a college tour where a bunch of teens from the program go to the Bay Area and explore a bunch of colleges. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Something funky went on with my Zoom here. But as I was saying, the Bay Area College Tour is a program within the Step Up curriculum or program as a whole. And it's when the Step Up teens go out and explore colleges in the Bay Area. And for me, it was a great opportunity because it kind of gave me insight into what the college experience was going to be like when I was a junior in high school. And I'm forever going to be grateful for that, because coming from a single mother household, I know that my mom wouldn't have had the time nor the day to, you know, take a whole week off of work and go tour colleges in the Bay Area with me, yet alone know what to do at these colleges. So it was a great experience and insight for me. And I remember specifically at this event, at this in this experience, I remember having a mental goal for myself and telling myself that if I was going to do anything right in college, it was going to be to study abroad. And that was because I learned about what studying abroad was during this trip. And sure enough, when I was at Mount Holyoke, I ended up studying abroad in Italy. And I spent there a whole semester, learned a lot. And at the time, I was studying translations and interpretation. And I thought that I wanted to be like a court translator or an education translator or something like that. But in Italy, I took a film course that kind of gave me insight about the entertainment industry. And I remember thinking to myself, how do people get to work for films and get to write out captions for these films and the translations? And I was like, and that led me into a whole rabbit hole into researching about the entertainment industry. I learned that that comes in post-production. And then I learned about production companies, and I learned about, different executives, like our amazing speakers for today. And I learned a whole bunch about like the entertainment industry. And so when I graduated from college, I wanted to move back to LA because I missed LA, and I felt like LA is the place to be if I wanted to be in entertainment. And having grown up here, I always had this mentality of like, in order to be successful, you kind of have to get out of the hood, right? But while being away from the hood, I saw that I missed it so much. And I remember thinking, well, no, in order to be successful, I could come back and change the hood. So I came back, and then I remember wanting to be involved and get my foot in the door in the entertainment industry. And at the time, when I got back from college, I was working two jobs. I was working part-time at Coffee Bean and Tea Leaf, and then I was working as a hostel receptionist. And eventually, I ended up taking over their social media accounts and managing their social media accounts, not knowing that social media was part of the entertainment industry at the time. And so I kind of wanted to get into, my thoughts was like wanting to get into the entertainment industry. And lucky enough and coincidentally enough for me, there was a job opportunity to be part of this agency. There's an opening position to apply to become an assistant at the top entertainment agency, CAA. And so I ended up, shooting my shot and applying for it. And I got the amazing support from two Step Up mentors, or two mentors that I met through the Step Up program, my sweet angels, Lubna and Stephanie, who helped me prepare for this interview. They had like multiple mock interviews with me, and they helped me, just prepare so that I can nail the interview with HR and also with the agent. I ended up getting the job, and so I worked at CAA for 2 years. Let me tell you, it was a bit overwhelming for me because, as you know, it was my first step into the entertainment industry, so I had to adapt very quickly. So it was interesting just learning everything all at once. And yeah, I was there for, like I mentioned, 2 years. And through CAA, I learned that my actual passion was within the digital space. And I remember that at the time, the digital space was just growing and it was becoming a thing. And so I ended up applying, after CAA, I ended up applying to this job at Collab, where I work at now. And it's basically one of the top digital agencies out there. And right now I work with top influencers, and I love it. I love working there. I love managing digital talent and helping them create their own brand and just helping them make a living out of doing what they love to do, which is create content. So yeah, that's where I'm at now. And that's enough about me. I wanted to introduce today our amazing moderator, Karen Horne. So Karen Horne is a senior executive with 20 years of experience within the entertainment industry. Got a long way to go. She has been recognized as a diversity and inclusion pioneer and pipeline builder. Karen recently joined WarnerMedia Group, where she is senior vice president of enterprise inclusion, overseeing inclusion programs and initiatives across the enterprise. Her background in finding and developing new talent allows Karen great ease in working with the creative world. With her corporate upbringing and work with C-suite executives allows her equal comfort in any boardroom. Ms. Horne serves on several industry boards and has spoken both nationally and internationally on diversity and inclusion best practices. Please welcome our moderator for today's inclusion, Karen Horne.
Thank you. Thank you, Rocio. That was so nice. I love hearing your story. I think your story is somewhat like all of our stories. I too am a child of a single mom, and there was no one in my family who did this before me. And so I love that you have paved your way. And I think those stories from the hood are the stories that we need to make our industry better. And so thank you. Thank you for your engagement and for having us today. I now get to introduce someone who I have known for a long time. I have admired her work for a long time, kind of from afar, but even up close. And I am honored to call her my friend and very grateful to also call her my boss. So Christy Haubegger is, she just got a new title added to her name. She is Executive Vice President of Enterprise Inclusion, Executive Vice President of WarnerMedia and Chief Enterprise Inclusion Officer, but she's also now Chief Communications Officer for the company. Just got that, that added to her plate. And it's added for a good reason, because her, reaches is wide, and her input for what we do is so on point and important. And I'll give you a little bit of a background about Christy, and then I'll let her speak for herself. She's a proud UT, University of Texas graduate. She is a Mexican American who was adopted by, as she puts it, two blonde people. She went to Stanford Law School and then created Latina Magazine. From there, she became a movie producer and then an agent at CAA for 14 years, maybe a little bit over that, where during that time, she increased their diversity, their diverse roster by over 1,400%. I think she probably started about almost a year ago at WarnerMedia, but we say in pandemic time, it feels like it's 10 years ago sometimes. So with that, I welcome Christy Haubegger. Hi, Christy.
Hey, I'm so happy to see you all. It's nice to see some familiar faces. I'm honored to be here.
So let's just chat a little bit. Like, I gave a brief background on your career and but why don't you tell us a little bit more about your journey? How did you actually get to where you are today?
Yeah. So I grew up in, Houston, and, you know, I didn't have any connection to the entertainment industry. I was thinking about this. I remember that one time when I was in like sixth grade, there was a weatherman, like the local weatherman, who came to our school and spoke in the auditorium. And it was like the biggest thing. And I remember I'd never seen anyone in real life who'd been on television. And like, I think it was the first time I ever thought about, oh, like, how do those people get on the TV? You know, like, I remember having that thought. I went to you know, I went to UT Austin and got a super marketable degree in philosophy. And so I pretty much had to go to law school, but I shocked my family by getting into Stanford, which was my long shot, you know, crazy application. And then as I was, you know, in law school, I took some business school classes because I had taken like a business law class and I really liked it. And I, you know, was somebody who was not really thinking about a career in business. Obviously I was in law school, but I remember being really intrigued by it. And so I took some business school classes at Stanford, at the Stanford Business School. And so I was suddenly struck by the fact that I'm not sure I'm in the right school. Like maybe I should have been in business school. And I wrote for a class project, I wrote a business plan for a magazine called Latina, which was at the time, you know, this kind of crazy idea because I'd been the person who grew up reading magazines and I felt like I never see myself, but it was interesting because friends of mine had grown up with Essence. And I remember thinking like, I wish we had something like that, but for us, but I didn't think I would ever have anything to do with that. But then I wrote this class project like paper, which was, a little bit after the 1990 census came out, and I realized that most of you were not around for the 1990 census, but you have to imagine, like, this was the first time that there were more Latinos in the United States than there were people in Canada, for example. And so it was like this big news. And the best part was that it was like on the cover of Time magazine, and it said, oh, it's going to be the decade of the Hispanic, you know, which I always think got rescheduled. And so I wrote this business plan like based on that and like the fact that we hadn't seen a magazine yet. And I'm going to try and accelerate the story. But basically, I ended up not practicing law. I ended up starting a magazine, which was really, really hard. It took me a number of years, but we launched Latina Magazine in 1996 with this young woman named Jennifer Lopez on the cover because we thought she might be the next big thing. Like she hadn't been cast in Selena yet. This was like after Money Train, I think. Like, you know, but I, you know, got into the magazine business, not because I wanted to necessarily, you know, be in the magazine business, but because I wanted to tell our stories and show our faces. And that was something I had missed as a young woman growing up. And so I did that and I ran that for 7 years, 8 years, I guess. And then I moved out to California to work as a producer because I wanted to do a different kind of storytelling. And one of the weird things about Latina is that really only Latinas read it. And I sort of wanted other people to see our stories. And so I thought I'd be a producer. And I worked on a couple of movies. The last one, you know, that it took a couple of years was a movie called Spanglish. And so I was executive producer on Spanglish. And the hardest thing about that was, you know, I thought I wanted to be a producer, but it turns out I don't like production. And unfortunately, those two are very, very connected. So I you know, I think after having a metabolism, like a professional metabolism, right, that was set up for getting a new product every 30 days, you know, like I had a new product every month. Like to work on one thing for 2 years was really hard for me, just personally. And then that one thing kind of comes and goes in a weekend. Now, I think if I maybe started in television, I would have liked it more. But I wasn't sure what I wanted to do. And I'd met some of the folks at CAA and kept in touch. And they offered to really create a role for me because they wanted to build a Latin roster and didn't have one. And so I had a lot of relationships from the motion picture side, as well as obviously the magazine world. And so I was able to help bring in and sign clients like Jennifer Lopez and like Salma Hayek and like Eva Longoria and America Ferrera. And one of the things that was really exciting for me was that I realized that, you know, and I appreciate that Rocio, like the CA, it's so interesting because if you're outside of the system, you don't realize like all the gatekeepers involved between something being an idea and something getting on screen. And I felt like if I could get more of, I have to fix my earring, of course, more of those women, for example, if I could elevate their voices and bring them up to this sort of larger platform and you know, help them start production companies, right? So we could tell our own stories, that would be a great thing. I'm gonna wrap this up, Karen, I promise. This is a really long story.
No, okay. I've heard this story and I love it.
Older you ask someone like their career story, it turns out it's long now. Okay, so then I loved being at CAA, but I had an opportunity. The folks at WarnerMedia called me about coming and leading, you know, diversity at WarnerMedia. Well, I really hadn't worked in diversity, like in the HR sense of it. And so I was like, well, I'm not really the right person for you because first of all, I know lots of great folks who would be ideal for this job, and I recommended a number of people and I passed, but they kept coming back to me. And I said, I kind of think you're thinking about this wrong. If you're sort of thinking about diversity, equity, inclusion in the sense of HR and the workforce, that's like one component of it. But in my opinion, you're missing the opportunity. Unless you figure out, how do you change your storytelling? How do you change your marketing? How do you change your workforce, you know, to be part of a whole? I think it's sort of necessary, but not sufficient, right, to see the change we wanna see. And the truth is, I care about inclusion because I'm enormously competitive. And you know what? I wanna win. And I feel like we're gonna win if we have a more inclusive team. We're gonna win if we appeal to a broader audience. That's how we win. That's how we drive innovation in our business. Because when there's 500 shows on television, if we show people something that they've already seen before, we're not gonna win, right? So we've gotta relentlessly innovate. And I think inclusion is actually how we do that in our business. So that's what I'm excited about. And, you know, frankly, to go from a company that was, you know, 3,000 people to go to a company of 30,000 people, I thought if I could have a fraction of the impact at WarnerMedia that I've had on CAA, then that will be a good use of me, you know, because I want to allocate the resource of me to have as much impact as I can in this world.
Well, okay, I mean, it's great. I mean, I think, look, I'm a champ. I've, you know, championed this for most of my career, and it's good business. You know, I've always talked to people about how tortillas outsell bread and salsa outsells ketchup, and that Black folks watch television real time more than any other group, and we want to see ourselves reflected on screen. So being inclusive is just, it's not only good for our morale and our the way we think, I think it's also just good for our business. But it's hard. Like it is hard to sometimes to teach, as we're finding now more so than ever, it's hard to tell people like, you need to change the way you're doing, like normal, like your status quo is not enough. And it can be, it can be really like an uphill battle. So what motivates you? Like what continues to motivate you to want, like I remember, and I'll just be brief about this because it's Christy's story, but at CAA, we went in when I was at a network to say like, what are you doing? And you were like, oh no, let me show you what we're doing. And it takes great motivation to keep pushing that rock uphill. So what motivates you to do that?
You know, I feel like there's a couple of things that motivate me. One is that I actually want to, well, let me say this. You know, I think that, you know, 30, 40 years from now, right, all of our grandchildren are going to ask us, like, what was it like back when you were a minority? Like, what was that like? And I want to be able to say that I helped tell our stories, right? Because we know that talent in this world is evenly distributed and the opportunities have not been. And when I look at, you know, the statistics about whatever the last decade, and you're like, okay, women directed 10% of the 10 largest motion pictures, I'm sorry, of the 1,000 largest motion pictures that have been released in the last decade. Well, you know that women are not 4% of the talent. There's no chance. Like the population distribution of talent doesn't work that way. And so I feel like I have a sense of, you know, mission about the work, but I also know that that's also how we win. And I think the thing that really motivates me is that I want to allocate the resource of me in a way that has the greatest impact I can on this world. And so I'm very thoughtful about that. I also, you know, this is an interesting thing. I'm not married and I don't have kids. And so I feel like that gives me a lot of additional capacity, right? Like the time that my colleagues and friends and peers, and by the way, I have a lot of children in my life and I love, you know, them. And I have a lot of, you know, well, let me say, I would say a lot. I have romance from time to time, right? And by the way, during a pandemic,
I've been married forever. It's only time to time. So
yeah, you know, but like a pandemic is actually a really good time to be single, because I can't imagine being in this house with someone 24/7 and not wanting to kill them. But I do think that I have capacity remaining, and I'm a super energetic person anyway, and I want to use that capacity that I have right now to have as much impact as I can on our business. Because I think what we do in our business matters. You know, if you think about it, like the stories we tell define not only what heroes look like in America, but around the world, because there are 7 billion people on the planet. Most of them never come to the United States, but they see our movies and our television. And we define who heroes are, and we define what a villain looks like. And I think that matters.
Characters count. And I love the story that you tell about Malala Yousafzai. So like, do you want to share that?
Yeah, sure. So a number of years ago, when I was at CAA, we were going to have a meeting with Malala Yousafzai, the young woman who was shot by the Taliban and who won a Nobel Peace Prize. And I was going to meet with her because we would end up signing her, you know, for her, like her speaking and her books and stuff. And so I was really excited to meet her. And I stayed up like till 2 a.m. reading her autobiography, which is called I Am Malala, which I recommend to everybody. So I stayed up late reading her book. And when I was reading the book, there were 3 different times in the book where she talked about the American television show Ugly Betty, because she and her friends had gone to Islamabad and bought DVDs of American television shows. And some of the references were like, you know, the Taliban's coming to my town and they're like threatening to burn all the Western entertainment, and I hope they don't take my Ugly Betty DVDs. And, you know, that's just a thought a young woman should never have to have, right? Is the Taliban is coming to my town and they're trying to do this. But in another passage, she says, I'm thinking about someday, you know, maybe becoming a journalist, because Betty works at a magazine and she's a young woman using her voice, and that makes me want to use my voice. Anyway, I was like, this is amazing. I can't believe this. And I worked with Salma Hayek at CAA, and I sent her a note. I was like, did you have any idea that this young woman loved Ugly Betty? And someone was like, oh my gosh, I had no idea. And she was funny because she was in London, so she emailed me back. And I was like, you know, we cannot doubt that the work we do matters. You can never doubt that the work you do matters. It ripples out in this world in ways you can't begin to anticipate. And then I actually amazingly got to introduce, Salma was going to be in LA the following week when Malala was still there, and I got to introduce the two of them. And let me just say, most work days are not that satisfying, but this was a particularly satisfying work day.
All right, we're going to take a little shift. Like, what do you think some of the biggest challenges in our industry are today?
I mean, obviously, you know, a pandemic and a recession, and I mean, those are huge industry challenges, just because economically, we don't have the volume of business we did, and even though I think that, you know, we're working ways to get back into production. Obviously, we're prioritizing safety and well-being over everything. And that's just really hard. I think, the other thing is how do we change who gets to tell stories, right? I think about the fact that you know, if you said, okay, we wish we had a whole bunch more Latino showrunners this year, right? Or Latina showrunners this year. You would have needed a whole bunch of Latina writers' assistants 12 years ago. And nobody was focused on that. So now we're trying to like scramble and catch up, and, you know, and I think that's just, it's very hard. And at the same time, I think trying to change, you know, trying to change an industry that has been very successful is hard. You're trying to change a company or an organization that is successful is very hard. And the reason for that is that people wrongly attribute some of their success to their lack of inclusion. So in other words, people look back and they're like, well, we were really, really successful and we weren't very inclusive then. If we become more inclusive, might we be less successful? And there's a false choice that people set up between excellence and diversity, right? That somehow those two, it's really a choice. And but that's a false choice. And we all know people like Karen Horne and Channing Dungey. Like, these folks are excellent, right? There is no compromise in quality, nor would we ever ask for that. But I think that's like a really big sort of mental challenge we've got to get people past.
Yeah, I mean, and that's, you know, the workplace. We're with the pandemic, these are our meetings, you know, these Zoom rooms, and you see how much lack of diversity there. And it's hard to cultivate a sense of belonging at your company, especially now with the added challenges of, you know, shift in the working environment because of the pandemic. But also, we've had a racial reckoning with the murder of George Floyd kicking it off, and now as recently as this week with another senseless shooting by the police. There is a racial reckoning going on, hopefully, in our industry. How do we continue to, and you, because that's kind of what you are charged with in your team, of cultivating a sense of belonging for the companies we work for?
Well, I think it's harder than it's ever been. And I want to say, I feel like we are all suffering, at the very least, a low-grade mental health crisis, right? Like, nobody is set up to live like this. And I think we've lost, you know, fellowship and community. And, you know, think about this, you know, a few months ago, or, you know, back in February or January, you know, if you were dealing with anxiety and trauma, right, you would go to a bar, you would go to your friend's house, you'd go see your parents, you would go to church, right? And we've lost all of that. And that fellowship, I think, has, that loss of fellowship, I think, has exacerbated, you know, what I think is sort of a mental health crisis that we're all living through. And then on top of that, you know, the racial trauma that has been inflicted on people. And if you didn't feel like you belonged in your workplace in the first place, how isolated is it right now? You know, it's just too much, right? It's too much. And so I think about this a lot, because how do we cultivate a sense of inclusion and belonging in a place where, like, we can't actually, you know, be in fellowship with one another, yeah. Right? So, like, because so much of it depends on that, I think it's very hard. On the other hand, I've been trying to find the silver linings in this, right? And one of them is that, you know, I have a lot of colleagues in Atlanta, for example, right? And I can see them every day right now, because I can actually see them. And I go through these moments where I'm like, oh, it's so great. I don't have to get on a plane for, you know, 5 hours to actually see these folks. I think it's very hard to just, you know, just to deal right now. It's just really hard. And I think we all have to give each other, like, some space and some compassion and, frankly, a sense of grace about things right now. And I think that the best thing we can do is to try and cultivate a culture where it's okay to learn out loud, right? A culture where we are going to affirmatively give people the benefit of the doubt, where we can really agree that we're all not our best selves right now. There's just no way. And so I think being deliberate and intentional about those things is really important.
Can we talk a little bit about what the work we've been doing at WarnerMedia to kind of foster that? Like, what have we been doing to foster not only for our employees, but for our content as well?
Well, I think there's a couple of things that we've done that I think were really important. And it's funny because we had this, you know, obviously, Karen, you came on 4 days before we got shut down, right? And poor Samatha came on after we shut down, and, you know, we always joke like, we threw a laptop on our porch and we're like, good luck. I think that you know, the work that we wanted to do suddenly became more urgent and focused in, you know, May 25th, right? With the murder of George Floyd. I think that so now it was like, oh yes, we're gonna do these like targeted development programs. And that's like, we were gonna do them in third quarter. I'm like, okay, we need to do them now, right? I think the best thing we did in some ways is, one of the best things we did was we brought on a counselor and a therapist and a PhD who specializes in racial trauma and racial healing. And we hosted sessions with her where, you know, people could help manage trauma, you know, in the first week after, the first couple of weeks after that. And then we hosted a really, really painful, like, town hall on race that began a series that we're calling Listen, Understand, Act, because we actually have to listen to one another. We have to understand one another. Everybody's like, do something now, but actually we need to sit in this pain for a little bit, right? Yeah. The urge is when your hand is over the fire to like pull away from it. And we decided that we thought it was more important to sit in it for a bit. And so we, you know, we did that work, and then we hosted listening sessions with the same therapist all over the company. So these interdisciplinary groups of people, you could just sign up. And it was remarkable to see everybody process trauma, process grief, process all of these things. But it helped us understand that we had a lot of work to do. And it helped us sort of prescribe, it was the diagnostic work that helped us prescribe that. So for example, you know, we did listening sessions with a lot of Black talent working in our shows, right? And we learned so much about their needs and their experiences. And we, as a result, we designed a showrunner intensive that Karen is in the middle of. Karen and Samatha are in the middle of. So we're doing a four-week training for showrunners on racial equity. And it really is a remarkable thing because it's a workshop. It's not like you're watching a video and learning, you know, like legal compliance requirements, but it's really how to be, like, it's called equity mindset for creative leaders, right? And it's really about becoming fluent in issues of racial equity and the lived experiences of, you know, the folks you work with and how to like build trust in an inclusive room where folks' experiences may be very different than yours. And you know, we've been really, really pleased with how engaged, you know, showrunners have been on that, because we know that it'll lead to, you know, better storytelling. We know it'll lead to less issues in the workplace.
One of the things we talk about with the showrunners is like having culture ads and not thinking about culture fits so much, about having culture ads and making new people who are not like you feel comfortable and welcome in a room. I think that goes also with if someone is a new employee. Like, so how do you have any suggestions or words of advice as I think a lot of this audience could be going and transitioning into new jobs, or if they were, to help you feel more at ease as you transition into a new career, because you've just done that, I've done that, you know, we all do that no matter where we are in our careers oftentimes. Do you have any words of advice for that?
I think, you know, it, you have to go in with a beginner mindset, because even if you have like the employee manual and you think you know how things work, you don't. Like, it's just, it's you, there's only, and it's slow. And I'm going to tell you a story that when I started at CAA, I had a meeting with this great leader named Lee Gabler. And Lee, I was like 30, it was like my job interview. I was 35 years old at the time, right? And Lee was this sort of tough, you know, older guy. And he sits down and he says, "All right, what can I tell you, kid?" And I'm like 35 years old. And I was like, okay. So I tried to think of like a smart question, right? Like what's the question that would get, you know, get this conversation back on track? Cause he sort of just threw that at me. And I said, "What advice would you give someone who's just starting in this business or at this company?" And he said, "Here's the thing. You college kids come in here." I'm literally 35. It's like, "You college kids come in here and you want to add value and you want to like prove, you know, that you're a superstar." And he's like, "And you're going to be running down the field. You can see the end zone. You hear the roar of the crowd. And you know what? You're not carrying the goddamn ball." So he's like, "I want you to shut up and listen and absorb before you try and do something impactful, because you, whatever you think you know by looking around, you don't really know." And I thought that was really good experience. It was a really good piece of advice. Yeah. Like, you're not carrying the ball. Like, you show up the first day, you think you're carrying the ball. Whatever you thought the job was, it's always something different than what you were told or even what was intended. And it just takes a minute. So be patient with yourself and be that like open-minded beginner person. Because if you did the same thing somewhere else, it won't be the same here. I don't care like what the job is.
All right, we're going to take some questions that I have in my chat from the group. What would you tell your 14-year-old self today?
Oh my gosh, my 14-year-old self. I was like sassy at 14. I was like,
"You're so sassy, Christy."
I am kind of sassy.
It's a good sassy.
You know, it's so funny. I'm like, my 14-year-old self, you know, I had a really limited worldview. I didn't know anything, you know. I would have said, like, "What is your dream?" And my dream was like, "Oh, maybe I can go to college," you know. And it's funny, I just found this progress report that somehow my mom had kept, and the teacher didn't like me because I talked a lot, shockingly. But the last line of this progress report said, "I fear for her academic future beyond high school." For your Mr. Castro.
Did you show him the Stanford letter of acceptance to law school?
Honestly, I never wanted to talk to Mr. Castro again, but like, I remember thinking that he might be right, you know? Or like, it was so much easier to doubt myself then. And so I would say, like, just dream bigger. You're capable of so much more. You haven't even seen the candy store that is the world and the things you can do in it. And that would be the thing I would say.
Where do you see the WarnerMedia story in 5 years?
Oh my gosh. Well, like, it's going to be the most remarkably inclusive, globally successful team. And, you know, I actually really want it to be, you know, people think of our product as being, you know, the shows that people watch or the movies that people see. And I actually think, like, our most important product is the experience people have working there. Mm-hmm. And so, like, I want that to be an incredible experience for people that challenges you, that lets you grow, that makes you feel like you belong, you know, no matter who you are. And we just did this thing in this workshop where we asked people about belonging, and it was, do you think that do you feel like you belong, right? And just so few people, like no matter who they were, like very few people were like, yes, I totally belong here, right? And then it said, you know, do you think people who are more diverse than you feel like they belong here? And that number was like half of the already not amazing number. And I was like, gosh, I would love to get everybody to the end of that scale. And working on trying to crack how that happens.
That was a great question. All right, this is a long question. You may have touched on some of, but it's a good one. How, Christy, have you been able to navigate the transition from being a super agent with big clients to a corporate environment where you are responsible for leading the charge on corporate strategy and communications around HR and DEI, diversity, equity, and inclusion for big content brands like WarnerMedia, HBO, and Turner, and now also the communications lead? What do you see as your current challenges and opportunities in your new role?
If I think about it too long, I'm going to cry, Karen.
I know. I was just like,
oh my God, that's really right. I don't know. No, I think, you know, I was really excited to be given the responsibilities of communication. I think it's enormously challenging because, you know, we're going through a difficult reorganization and restructure, and that's, you know, taking the comms job at that moment, I've said to a lot of friends, is like catching a falling knife. But you know what? I caught the knife. Let's go. And I think that I mean, I am excited about the fact that I want to, and we can sort of infuse an inclusive mindset into everything we do and in every way we show up in the world and in everything we say. And that is like super exciting to me. The learning curve is like this, which I also love. I mean, for me, the worst thing about a job is when the learning curve flattens out and you're just in the maintenance business. And after 14 years in the agency business, I learned from the best of the best, you know, but I wasn't learning at the same pace 14 years in, right? And so the most exciting thing for me is to be able to take, and I would say that like my point of view on this is that, you know, I've had a lot of jobs and I've had one career, right? I've had one mission. Each of these jobs, I was trying to achieve something similar, right? And I feel like this feels like a culmination for me of a lot of those threads coming together. But I also still feel like an agent, right? I'm an agent advocating on behalf of equity. I'm an agent advocating on behalf of inclusion, right? I'm still an agent in many ways, and my job is persuasion. Yeah. And I'm still persuading. It's just, I'm persuading something, folks to do something different, to behave differently. I'm persuading you to choose maybe not your personal comfort or familiarity, but choose the thing that'll make us better, right?
Awesome. Yep. I believe that as well. I mean, I think every job I've ever had in my career, while during that time, I probably thought this was the best job. I'm going to keep this job forever and ever. It's actually helped me get to now where I'm in actually the best job that I want to keep forever and ever. So
I will tell you, when I was leaving Latina, which was like a really hard mixed thing, even though I knew I needed to grow and do something else, it was really hard. Because I had been defined by this job, right? I'd been defined by this thing. And I, you know, out loud, I was like, but what, you know, what is everybody gonna do without me? Like, what's the magazine gonna do without me? And I was like, really, what am I gonna do without the magazine? Who am I outside of there? And my friend, Maya Harris, who is like one of my best friends to this day, said this amazing thing to me, which was, I think everything you've been doing up until now is just getting you ready for what you're really gonna do. And that's been true all of my life.
Yeah. This question says, I like the observation that we would have needed Latinx writers assistance 12 years ago to have showrunners now. How can we make the pipeline, that's why I like the question, not just in the writer's room, but in the executive suites as well, better and more effective?
Well, I think part of it is actually that So, you know, people like me going to college didn't know there were careers like this. I actually think a lot of it is organizations like this making more visible all the different paths and roads into this business. You know, you can't be what you can't imagine. And you know, the women on this call can help a lot of people imagine. And so the executive side is really, really interesting because, you know, when we, years ago at CA, when we would go out and recruit, and my friend Ruben Garcia would go to these campuses, first of all, no one knew what an agent was, right? They were like, secret agent? What's an agent do? And you realize people say, well, I don't think I want to work in entertainment. I don't have any talent, right? And like, people thought that was what they thought of as the entertainment business. And so you have to like start with like letting people know what is possible. Also, letting people know there's not a specific degree that prepares you for this. Mm-hmm. Character prepares you for this. Yes, being well-read prepares you for this. Being knowledgeable about the world prepares you for this. But you can have a degree in economics, you can have a degree in business, you can have a degree in finance, and use those tools to make storytelling happen, because we need all those things. So I feel like that's the biggest thing.
I think we have time for one more question. What metrics, studies, and data thought leaders do you look to make the business case for hiring diverse executives inside the company? Because so much emphasis is placed on hiring diverse writers, directors, and talent, touching the content piece of it.
Yeah, you know, if you have a chance, there's a friend of mine who's at the University of Michigan named Scott Page. And, you know, you can find his, there's two thinkers I like. One of them is Scott Page. He's an academic. I can't remember the name of his book. It's like The Diversity Bonus. But it's really like an academic look at how teams, you know, when people think they're hiring the best, they often mean that they're hiring people who remind them of themselves, right? Right. Because you're like, well, that's excellent, right? And so, but he talks about how teams across every, he has the talk on YouTube called How Hiring the Best Doesn't Result in the Best Team. And then the other thing, and he's not exactly an academic, but he's a personality and speaks about these things, is a guy who has a podcast on NPR called Hidden Brain, Shankar Vedantam. And I can type both of those names in the chat if you want. But Shankar Vedantam has an episode about the edge. And it's why you get better creative results when you have different experiences that come together. It's the edge at which they come together and meet that actually propels greater innovation in creativity. And there's a lot of, he interviews a lot of academics about that. So those are two things that I think are worth looking at. And then, you know, there's a lot of, and then there's a lot of academics who study this, but I think Scott Page, but if you go to, if you go to YouTube and look at some of Scott Page's talks, you'll see that, and, you know, I mean, if you want an academic perspective on it.
Great. Well, thank you, Christy. I think our time is up, and so I am going to pass it back to Amanda. It's been fun talking to you. I'll talk to you later.
I'll see you at the staff meeting.
Thank you both so much, Karen and Christy. That was amazing. We so appreciate you taking the time to sit with us and chat with us. And thank you everyone for the thoughtful questions. I loved the Q&A portion. And so now I would like to share the next big thing that we have at Step Up. So I'm gonna share my screen for a second to share with you all the invitation. So we'd like to invite you to attend our first digital summit, Step Up Together, on September 10th. If you haven't signed up yet, you can do that today by just grabbing your phone and taking a screenshot of that QR code, and that can help you register. And so what we will have on this day are sessions focused on leadership, being your best self, mentorship, professional development, style, social justice, networking, and so much more. So we'd love to have you attend, and we have an app that will have you access all the content for the day. So we really hope that you will take the time and join us. We can't wait to see you then. So that's what we have for you today. Thank you all so much, and we'll see you next time.
Damn, I've been working real hard on myself and my health and my happiness. Hit pause on my laptop time and my mind been working less. Cause I lost myself, I've